first Saturday, and it's 11 o'clock. Hiya, Mark. Topping, how are you doing?
John Noble, I am very good indeed. How are you? It's a beautiful day today.
Yeah, what a beautiful day. You still doing your weeding?
I am doing weeding, but I'll tell you what I did this morning, John. I got up at about 5:30, 6 o'clock and did the dawn chorus. I walked up into the Dublin mountains, into the forests, and listened to the birds.
Oh my God, you're going back to nature, Mark. All this COVID is still having such a positive effect on you.
Exactly. I've never been so close to nature in all my life, John.
Oh, that is great. Well, we have a great treat today for our listeners, for our Badminton fans and followers all over the world on this Badminton Talk podcast, of course, sponsored by the Q Shuttle. Mark, boy, are our listeners in for a wonderful treat today. What do you think?
Oh, absolute legend of the Irish game we have on. John, I can't wait for this interview.
Yeah, we have two, not just one. We have two. So, Mark, I'm going to just, first of all, let's give our listeners a listen to the theme music. Are we ready? Ready for this? Okay.
We always do this, John. Let's
okay.
do it.
Okay.
Passing by like Lady Godiva. I'm going to go, go, go. There's no stopping me. Good time, I'm having a ball.
Yeah, don't stop me now. We obviously have two amazing guests on the Badminton Talk podcast. And I, Mark, are going to introduce the first of these two guests here. And we have the three-time Olympian, Chloe Magee, 2008 in Beijing, 2012 in London, and 2016 in Rio. Yes, so indeed.
The poster girl of Irish badminton, according to Wikipedia, but certainly the face of Irish badminton for the past decade and more. She's actually on the big billboard out in Baldoyle. She's on the billboards in Whitehall Road. And Chloe, who is a singles and mixed doubles specialist. She was ranked 22 in singles in May 2014. She was ranked 21 in mixed in August 2015 with Sam. And not too bad. She's also ranked 59 in doubles with Bing Huang back in 2010. So we have to also remind our listeners here that that Chloe Magee also has a record of national titles in Ireland. She had in 10 singles titles, 4 doubles and 12 mixed. And today, at the young, tender age of 32, Chloe is aiming to hopefully qualify for a fourth Olympics. Chloe Magee, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. That was a big introduction there.
Yeah, thank you. I was trying to remember all my stats and numbers and play with the techo. So, Mark, over to you.
Yeah, welcome, Chloe. It's just an absolute pleasure to have you on the podcast. Thank you for coming on. Absolutely brilliant. Now, my job is to introduce our other guest, the one and only Sophia Noble, who is 16 years old, at half the age of our legendary Olympian, our guest, Chloe. Welcome, Sophia, and thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy training schedule today. I'm just going to give you a bit of, just go through some of your results, Sophia, and I'll let you in. Sophia has won every national underage category in singles at under 13, under 15, under 17, and under 19. She also has won a lot of girls' doubles and mixed doubles with some excellent partners, also at under 13, under 15, under 17, under 19. She's been ranked number one more or less for the last 5 or 6 years at under 13, under 15, and under 17 age categories. And when you move up into the under 19 age category, I'm expecting you to be number one in that as well. Sophia, no pressure, no pressure. That's according to the Badminton Ireland ranking pages. But for me, the highlight result so far of your career, Sophia, was at the European Under 17 Women's Singles event. I think it was in Poland in 2019.
Yeah.
Wait, what was it, Poland?
Yeah, Poland.
Yeah, where you got to the quarterfinal of a huge event. I think it was 128. And while you were a year younger than most of your other competitors, and you lost out actually in the quarterfinals to the eventual winner, I can't remember the Russian lady's name. Two sets, wasn't it? It was two close sets.
Thank you.
And just one other thing I want to highlight, which I think is an incredible achievement, because you've also won a Gold Star women's singles event in England. The English circuit is a really tough circuit to win on, and so that was a big achievement as well. I think you did that possibly in 2018 or 2017, so that was another really good win. And welcome to the podcast, Sophia.
Thank you so much for having me here.
God, Mark, I think we'll need to do an extra podcast here with that introduction. We used so much time up, we haven't even let them say a word. But no, it's great to have two wonderful athletes and two females on this podcast. I was just thinking, Mark, when you were saying the numbers, like Sophia's 16 and Chloe's twice the age of Sophia, and then you're kind of twice the age of Sophia. That kind of it's something like that. Okay, well, look, Chloe and Sophia, to start with Chloe, there's so many questions that we want to ask you, and our listeners on the Badminton Talk podcast want to hear from all over the world, and they'll be eager, of course, and tuning in. Of course, time is our enemy, but let's pack in as much as we can while we have both of you between your training, as I know this is a really busy time for you, and also congratulations on a wonderful performance in the All England not so long ago. It was absolutely privileged to see, you know, an Irish set of players performing at the highest level. It was world class, and just wanted to say that. But to kind of bring ourselves down to earth, and as you go up for the next build, let's just begin at the start, Chloe. How did you get started in badminton? You know, and to a lot of our juvenile listeners, what age did you start? And why badminton? Why not tennis? Why not another sport?
Yeah, I think I get asked this so many times, how I started in badminton and where did I start? But it's the same answer I've always given. My dad, he ran the local club. And I think when I was younger, badminton was such a social outlet. You know, I was always going. If he was going, I always wanted to go. And when I was like 4 or 5, you know, he started hitting with me in the hall. So my dad deserves a lot of credit to my career. And yeah, he took us, Sam and myself, and all my brothers and sisters, really. But, you know, we put a lot of time into just playing us singles from a very, very young age. And we're always annoying him to go to the hall. So yeah, I think badminton because my dad loved it. He just wanted us to play, and he was a big fan. He's still a big fan, and he's always been so good with our career. And you know, even from a young age, like, you know yourself, it's like driving around to all the tournaments. And
yeah, taxi man.
Around. Yeah, there's a lot of waiting. There's a lot of, you know, making sure we've got food, we've got this, we've got that. So you know, he put all those hours in, and that's where it all began.
Yeah, and it wasn't a talk to try another sport. He always wanted badminton. That was it. It wasn't like kicking a Gaelic football up there in the hills of Donegal, which I'm sure you know, would be quite tempting, you know, with all the Gaelic clubs.
Yeah, well, I think whenever I was younger, I played all sports. Whenever I was at school, especially secondary school, you know, I did everything. Anything that was to get out of class to go play sport, I was going, you know, I did everything. And I just, like, I always kind of loved PE and, you know, any sport. I'm actually, like, I'm such a sports fan. I could watch nearly all sports, and I'm just intrigued by how people train and how do they get the best out of themselves in all sports. You know, it's just, you know, even being in this type of sport and watching other sports and the way that they train and the different things they do to get better, to get faster, to get quicker, all those things like really intrigue me. So I'm really, really into, I'm just a sports fan, I would say.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Chloe, to any of our listeners, particularly the younger juveniles. It's really good to try out lots of sports when you're very young, and the skills that you pick up in those other sports will put you in good stead for whatever sport you decide to specialise at whatever age. And you'd certainly encourage very young players, Chloe, to try as many sports out, just not, don't necessarily try one, be flexible.
Yeah, like, I mean, whenever I was at school, I played a lot of hockey, and even though I wasn't really that amazingly good at hockey, it actually helped my whole body just become strong. And, you know, I was always, like, running the pitch. You don't even realise you're doing so much cardio. Yeah. You just run up down the pitch all the time. And, like, my legs have always been quite strong, and actually I've been lucky to have, like, very few really serious injuries. And I actually put a lot of that down to doing all the different sports when I was younger, because I was out and I was enjoying it. So I wasn't actually going in and like training every day, like really serious, but yet I was always out being active and doing these different skills in the hockey pitch with my friends, and it didn't even feel like I was training. So
yeah,
things like that I think is important, especially when you're young, that you don't get into this where, you know, oh, I have to train, or I have to train. You go out and enjoy it. You know, that is the most important thing. So, you know, I was always out playing all sports, and it's helped my body in general to get physically strong from a young age without even knowing that I'm doing half the things that I was doing.
Yeah, brilliant. That's brilliant advice. Yeah, absolutely. Mark, over to you next. We'll keep moving on. Thanks, Chloe, for that. I think that's answered that question extensively well. So unless there's a follow-on question, Mark, over to you. Next question.
Oh, no, just comments. Yeah, no, I was exactly the same. I loved the hockey myself. I used to play loads of hockey and tennis and cricket, and it just is a fantastic way. You're getting stronger without realizing you're getting stronger, I think, and having fun. That's the main thing.
Yeah.
I have a question for Sophia. Sophia, thank you very much. And I think it might be thanks to you, because you train alongside Chloe quite a bit, that you managed to persuade Chloe to come on to our podcast. So thank you, Sophia. You train alongside Chloe, and how does it feel at the age of 16 to be training with the superstar of Irish badminton, a world-class player and the face of Irish badminton for over a decade now?
It is really amazing. I feel so fortunate to have been given the opportunity to actually train at all at the moment, but to be able to do it with someone who I've looked up to so much since a young age. I mean, I remember when I was younger going to under 13 competitions, or even before that, watching senior events from the perspective of me not actually playing in them, and always seeing players like Chloe and some of the other people who I train with in the academy at the moment, and just looking up to them so much and just absolutely aspiring to be like them. So to be able to train alongside someone like Chloe is just like kind of surreal, like every session coming in and seeing that she's playing. And she's also really kind to me. She always gives me great feedback, so that just motivates me even more, I think.
Normally the Nationals is played alongside the under 15s, if I'm right. They tend to do those two sequences, and I do recall Sophia and some of the other players loving the fact the senior players are in that same hall, you know, loving it, and just, you know, literally saying, oh my goodness, they're looking at my game, or they're watching. I mean, I don't know if you can go back and remember, Chloe, when you were 16 or a little younger, and you might have some older players watching you. There's a wonderful buzz, and I think that's partly what Sophia's brought out there. It is such a great giving back to juveniles, you know, in that setup, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I actually remember when I was growing up, the superstars of Irish badminton were Mark and Bruce Topping. And I remember clearly actually being at one of the events in the Shires. I don't know if you remember, Mark, but I'm pretty sure you had two Malaysian sparring partners over at the time, and the two of you guys were at the top of your game back then. And, you know, I remember us just watching these two guys, and even like the likes of Keelan Fox and these. And, like, Keelan's one of the players that I remember when I was very young. I remember just watching her and thinking she was just such a brilliant player. So, like, when I go back to that time, I do remember it quite clearly, but those guys were the guys that were above me, and that you're going, and that's the first time you see proper badminton being played live. And those things do stay in your head. And like, even the way just you guys were playing and training, and you know, I'm pretty sure afterwards, whenever you finished the tournament, I think you just went back in to train again, pushing yourself. So, wow. You know, those wee things, they kind of, you know, they stand out in your head, and you're like, okay, this is where Badminton's at, and this is where, you know, we have to get to. So I think Karen Bing too was another one that was, she was always a lot older than me. And like you said in the intro, like, I played doubles with her for a while. So, you know, she taught me a lot. And, yeah. You know, there are certain things that you can take. You can take something from every player, but Karen was, she was just such a natural player. And, you know, watching these guys play and the quality of their strokes and, you know, the speed that they were playing at it back then, you're like, okay, you know, we have to up our game here.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
The way I look at it is, what I'm amazed at is how the next generation always seems to take it up another level and improve. So it's a tribute to you. We reached a certain standard, but you guys are pushing it even further, this current generation. So just keep going at it. I love watching it. It's just brilliant to see it improving each generation.
Yeah, but also,
I think as well, like, sorry, John.
No, go ahead. No, sorry. We have a habit of interrupting you. Sometimes it's hard to get a word in with Mark, but Chloe, you can always interrupt. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, but I mean, like, you know, yourself and Bruce, you know, you're playing at this level, and if we wouldn't have had you guys playing at this level and showing us, you know, how to be professional and how to play properly, then we would never, ever have anything to aspire to get to this level, to try and bring it to the next level. And I think it's so important. Like, people always forget, like, how important it is to have senior players above you to look up and be like, okay, this is what I need to do. This is where the game is at. You know, even sometimes you go in and you might have three good players on the court, but they don't know what speed to be playing at. They don't know what speed the exercises should be fed at. Mm. So it's so important. Like, you know, you set the level, and then we had to come to that level and try and, you know, make it further. So without the senior players, without these players before us, we would never have come to this level. So, you know, it's a credit to you guys that we are where we are as well.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah, no, it's nice. Yeah. I think that is the way it works. You just keep passing the information down the generations.
Yeah.
And hopefully younger people listen. And, well, they do. From what I see, I'm so impressed with this young generation. They're so hungry. They're so keen. And they just want to learn. And it's fabulous to watch.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I was also going to say, you know, the facilities are getting better every year. The new home of badminton in the NIA is just fantastic. And, you know, you deserve it. And all players deserve to be in the arenas that you compete in week in, week out. I often say to Sophia, you're so lucky. Remember when Chloe Magee had to play in a hall in Raphoe? We know that story. Anybody that's been listening to Chloe over the years knows that story about having to look at DVDs. I think in those days there wasn't YouTube. The smartphone only came in 2007 when Steve Jobs launched it. And it's so easy today to just to do all this and video your play an instant. So, of course, things are helping improve the standards. You know, it's great to see that, Chloe, and long may that continue.
Sure.
Yeah.
Like, it's something that, you know, Irish badminton has needed for so, so long. You know, we've needed good facilities. And, you know, going forward now, you've nearly got no excuse as to why you can't train and train to the best of your ability, because you have the world-class gyms, you have the world-class facilities. They're always trying to bring in people to make you better. Like, we're always trying to bring in sparring, which, you know, I think, as I said, well, Bruce and Mark started back, you know, they brought in the legs, and they knew that the game had to be faster, had to be better, so you have to bring people in. So almost nearly no excuse. Like, you know, you're chatting about video games. I remember when I can't even remember what age it was, when I played one of my first senior tournaments, and the finals in, you know, that Calder Hall, Whitehall, the courts.
Oh, yeah, the Icebox, 5 and 6, yeah.
Yeah, God,
yeah.
I don't know why they had the finals in there. I think they set it up, you know, as a big arena, and I was playing a match. And Pat Marm was actually commenting, or he was commenting on the
oh,
final.
Oh, right, good old
and
Pat.
Somebody gave my dad the DVD after the match, and I was very young at the time, and I would say a very raw player.
Yeah.
And I remember one of the comments that sticks out in my head that he said, he goes, you know, Chloe's a good player, but whenever she fixes her racket carriage, then she'll be a very good player. And I was just sitting there thinking, wow, you know, he's like, I thought my racket carriage was just terrible. And the whole way through the final, that's all he kept saying was, oh, my racket carriage wasn't good there. The racket carriage isn't good there. She had a racket carriage better, she would have done better there. I remember just sticking out in my head. Like, it was the first time I'd ever heard somebody, like, commenting on my match and, you know, just pointing out all my weaknesses. And I was also, like, give me some compliments as well, but it was like, I just couldn't believe it. I remember sitting as a young player thinking, oh my God, that was the first time, you know, somebody's like, oh, you know, that racket crash needs to be better. You know, if it ever gets better, she could be quite good. Like, I never, like, there's certain things stick in your head, but that is the one for me, was that, just that particular match was crazy.
Yeah. Wow, that's a real interesting story. Pat Maron, who's done a lot for the game of badminton as well over the past, and I think he's still hitting shuttlecocks. You know, of course, back when COVID's back, so it's good to see that he's keeping himself busy too. Now we have about 7 minutes on this first part with Chloe, so I'm going to go on to the second question, and if we've to stop it quickly, we will. We'll move on to our part two quick after that. But Chloe, to many juvenile listeners to our Badminton Talk podcast, if they wish to follow in your footsteps, which we know many look up to you, of course, you are the guide here. We know there's no shortcuts in badminton. You know, you need to be obsessed if you want to, you know, be the best that you can. So what commitments, or maybe the word is sacrifices, did you have to forgo? And kind of the second question then is, you know, when you look at someone, say, like Sophia's age, what shift in training do they have to move to next? So there's kind of two parts to that question. So the first one, I suppose, is let's deal with that one. What kind of sacrifices or what you have to forego to get as good out of your game when you're kind of trying to improve where you are?
I think one of the biggest things that comes down to how much you want it as a person yourself. You know, sometimes when I was growing up, I was always trying to almost please my dad, like, you know, try to be really good, and then he wanted me to be really good. And, you know, there's times I was going to tournaments and I don't even think I was really enjoying it, but, you know, he always knew, he always seen something in me, and he kept me going. And even, like, it's a difficult time, especially for young girls, those teenage years, you know, there's a lot of things happening, there's a lot of things going on in your life, and, you know, you always kind of stray to what, you know, what your friends are doing or what everyone else is doing. And, you know, to be serious at your teenage years and to focus only on badminton, it's almost uncool to be like that. And, you know, my dad always kept me going, like, even times when I just didn't want to play badminton, he was always keeping me going. And at the time I was kind of like, you know, I don't know if it's the right word, is like, you know, I was kind of like, why is he making me do this? But then when I got there and got to my first Olympics, you know, I look back and I credit everything to him, because if it wasn't for him, I definitely would not have kept playing badminton. So I think it definitely comes down to how much you want it. Like, you know, sometimes you do need to push in the right direction. You have to go through the really bad times to get to kind of the better times. And, you know, it's very easy to just stop at the first hurdle, but you really just have to keep pushing through, because there is better times coming. Like you said about sacrifices, I think for, you know, now for the kids growing up, it is, as I said already, you know, it's almost, there's no excuse why you can't train your best. When I was growing up, there was none of these facilities. We didn't have really a full-time national coach. We don't have, I didn't even know what the gym was before I left Ireland. So I had to leave and go to Sweden when I was 17. And although, like, now, you know, 17, people are like, oh, well, there's people going to college at that age anyway, you know, going to another country that doesn't speak English. Although everyone did speak English, but it wasn't their first language.
Yeah,
to train
very tough.
In a new setup, and never having left really Donegal before, never mind, you know, going to Dublin or whatever. I've never even been outside Donegal really that much. And to start a whole new life on the other side of Europe was just, like, one of the toughest things I've ever had to do. And to go there and just be like, you know, I was kind of set on a path to college. All my friends were going to college. I just wanted to go and live that normal life. Didn't see, at that time, it was so, nobody had ever really done it. You know, Scott was obviously one of the biggest ones for me. He had went to Denmark. He had actually, you know, came out of school early and went to Denmark to train full-time badminton. So he was kind of the first one that I was like, okay, well, you know, he is actually doing it. So there has to be something to this. Like, so then I went to Sweden, and it was probably the toughest 6 months of my life, was that first 6 months of going to Sweden, because I just did not enjoy it at all. I just found everything really, really difficult, and I became really homesick. And, you know, even though 17, you know, you think that's old, but it is, you're still quite young, and you're still going through so much. You know, you're learning about yourself and becoming the person that you're becoming, and then here you are on the other side, you know, in Sweden, and it just was really, really tough. And to do it and not really believe that I was good enough to be a badminton player, a full-time badminton player, to make a living out of being a badminton player, that was tough.
Yeah, and especially as you said, Chloe, there, as all your friends are, enjoying themselves and having the parties, and you're out there, is certainly, at 17, that is very, very young. Chloe, the second part of the question, curious to really ask you, Sophia is around, the age where you start to see shifts in training needed to move to the next level. And there's a lot of players in and around Sophia's age in the academies and around the country as well in their own clubs. What kind of commitment do you need to move for the next couple of years to what's required? How much more training is needed on a average weekly basis than maybe, just playing a couple of times?
Yeah, I think she is at that age now where she's almost going from junior to senior. So she has a lot of ability. And I think one of the things that's so important when you're moving from this age group, when you go from junior to senior, is you get away from the mindset where it's just getting it over and in enough times and, making your opponent tired. Of course, that is part of badminton, but it's important that she's learning to develop good strokes, that she's learning to be able to hit winners, that she's, looking to win points rather than looking for her opponent to make mistakes,
Right.
I think a good thing always at this age is to watch the best players play. I know people always say that, you should watch YouTube or whatever, but when you watch someone like this type, Carolina Marin, and you see her strokes and how she can win quick points of having really sharp, really good strokes. It's not about just getting it over and in for 1 hour or over and in for whatever length of time. It's about actually doing something when you're doing these routines and you have a purpose to when you're doing them. And, I think it's sometimes you get dragged into this mindset of, just keeping it on the court. It's, it does work at junior level. It does because, everyone's of different physical ability at those young ages. But when you get to seniors, everyone's at the same. And, of course, you have to have a very high level of physical ability to even compete in badminton. But it's so important when you want to go to beat these players in senior badminton is that you have good strokes, that you have weapons, that you have things that can cause people problems. And I think that's one of the things, even if I go back to my singles, I always think if I would have just developed better strokes, if I would have had more weapons, I could have been such a better player. And sometimes I just felt like I was just getting the shuttle back and getting it back. And, of course, it's good to do that, but you need to have that bit more now, and you need to be able to, when you are training, to know that you're training smart, that you're not just going in and trying to get through 2 hours of putting it back on the court, and you're on autopilot rather than thinking about what am I doing, what am I actually doing with the shuttle, am I dangerous, do people find me hard to play, and that is so key to someone off Sophia's level. And you're saying how many hours.
Yeah.
I think, it depends on the quality of your training. There's so many things at that age. She needs to develop her strength, and a lot of that comes from body weight stuff. I remember I used to do a lot of work with actually Shab Williams whenever I was playing singles.
Yes,
to build up
she's
the muscles
still...
around my feet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, to build up, the muscles around my ankle, to build all this stuff that makes your body so strong and robust, and it keeps you from picking up these wee small injuries that put you out for a week or put you out for a couple of days, or then you're out for another week, and all these wee things build up. So the more time that you're losing, then, that's the last time you're developing. So, it's about quality. Of course, she has to be on court every day, trying to get good quality out in the sessions. But it's important when she is on court that, if you don't know what's going on in the routine, that you're asking the questions, that you're not just then getting it over and in, because I really believe in this day and age of badminton, that's not enough.
Yeah, I often think, Chloe, younger players, their mindsets and tend to be more thinking about the score when they're training, and it's a normal thing because everybody wants to win. But when you're doing training is not really the score second. It's about, hearing someone that comes back to say, "Look, I actually trained really well today," and then you ask them, "What was the score?" "Well, I actually lost, but I played really well." That's the kind of thing that you're encouraging, or to have that. That's the change that's needed. You need to. I don't know if it's like take more risks or try to be a better attacker, but use training for the training purpose to make you a better player.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's obviously very, very important to have a winning mindset. Like, I mean, you can't be someone, you see it so many times, people go, they really enjoy training, but they actually don't enjoy playing games because of the pressure and everything. And I think when I was growing up, actually, a lot of us, because I was playing against Sam and Dan and Josh, and I had an older sister, Martin, and my dad was always putting us in to play games, so we always got this mindset where we wanted to beat each other, so it was, you know, I play, I always want to win. And, you know, you go home and you're sitting at the dinner table, and he's like, oh, I beat you, you know, all this. But even though, you know, it's so annoying, but if you win, you're, you know, you're loving it. If you lose, you're hating it. And I think it is important to have, like, that winning mentality, that you want to win. It's very, very important. But I remember one night I was coaching in the academy, and I'm not going to say any names, but I put two people on to play each other, and they came off, and I can't remember whichever one won anyway. And, you know, one of them was standing, and they were, like, almost crying because they had lost. And I remember watching the game, and the game was awful. Like, it was really, really bad badminton, because the two of them were just playing so bad, they were so tense to lose against each other. I remember sitting down and I chatted to both of them afterwards, and I was like, yeah, but what were you doing in the game? And I said, I really don't want to lose to her. I really, really don't want to lose to her. And then I spoke to the other one, I said, I really don't want to lose to her. I can't go home if I lost to her. And I was like, but, you know, really, you've got nothing out of that game. Like, either of you didn't get anything out of the game, because it was just literally a game of trying to, who could get the shuttle on the floor quick enough and who could get the most points, but there was nothing to the game. Like, so sometimes when they are treated, it does become like, you know, you have to have that winning mentality, but you also have to realize that, you know, you want to be playing good badminton, because when you go to play tournaments, it's not about beating this person in the academy. It's not about being the best in Ireland. You're very small. Like, to be the best in Ireland, you're a small fish in a big pot, or a big fish in a small pond. When you go to abroad, you need to be playing good badminton to beat these players. So if you're in training every night, you're trying to replicate what you want to do internationally, then that's actually better. If you're coming out and, okay, you lose, but you've done something in that game, it's probably better than going in and winning all night and going home saying to your mum, oh, well, I won all my games. You know, it doesn't really stand for a lot, because people lose in training all the time. Like, I can sit here now and tell you that Sam, myself, do not win every day in training, even though that we would be considered the best mixed pair at the centre. We don't win every day. And, you know, and that's, you know, and people are like, oh, but, you know, you beat them so easy at the Nationals. It doesn't matter. It's completely different. In training, everybody can lose to everybody. And I don't go home at night and cry for the whole night if I've lost to Paul and Rachel in training. You know, because I know the next day when maybe I'll be the one that comes. You know, it just works that way. And sometimes you need to get the feeling that in training that, okay, yes, you do have to win, but that you're also playing good badminton and you're doing the right things.
Brilliant. That is stunning insight from three-time Olympian Chloe Magee here on the Badminton Talk podcast. My God, Chloe, I think only time I think you might be crying if you're watching Grey's Anatomy or something like that. I believe that can be weepy. Sophia tells me that. She's on the 17th series, is it, or something like that? I'm not sure, but yeah, that is so great. Just, you know, train like you're going out to play one of those internationals and just forget about everything else. Get your mindset really right in training, and brilliant. Right, Mark, I think it's your time to bring in Sophia again to the podcast.
Absolutely. Yeah. And just to back up on everything Chloe just said, I think it is, I think the word is training with purpose. You need to have a very clear vision what you want to achieve in the next hour you have on this court, and you just, if it's, for example, hitting with incredible accuracy, you go for the lines on smashes. It doesn't matter if you lose the match, hit those lines with your smashes, and doesn't matter about the result. You've got to have just one clear purpose of every single session. Train hard. Anyway, that's brilliant. Sophia, at what age were you introduced to badminton, and who were your first coaches, and what was so attractive about the game of badminton for you?
Well, I think I started playing badminton at about the age of 4 or 5 when my dad introduced me to it. He was probably my first main coach. He'd bring myself and my brother Dylan down to Mount Pleasant or to Whitehall Road, any of the local clubs, really. And sometimes he'd just get us watching games that he'd be playing with his own sparring partners, or else he'd, you know, give us some feeding to do on court, and we'd play against each other. I think that was the time where I was first introduced to badminton as a sport. And then, as you know, you, Mark, you were also my first kind of formal coach outside of my dad, my first kind of coach outside my family generally. So you're just amazing. I remember when I was younger, bringing me and Dylan onto the court and showing us some footwork routines, just making the game sound so fun and enjoyable. So whenever I went to training, it wasn't considered, you know, an effort. It was just, I'm going to have fun with Mark today and doing silly routines that just like would be seamless to me, but they actually probably impact my footwork today, and even some of them I'd still use in my warm-ups and my training. So all of those things were kind of what started me off in badminton. And then Dan would have been my kind of first coach in the more kind of academy environment. So all of you were my first coaches. And then I think in terms of badminton as a sport compared to other sports, because I played so many when I was younger, tennis, swimming, I did dancing, which is, it's kind of aerobic as well. So I just like was involved in so much when I was younger because it was really important to my dad and my mom, my parents. They wanted to encourage me to expose myself to as much as I could. And I enjoyed everything. Like Chloe said, I was like quite athletic when I was younger. I loved PE. I loved running. I loved competing, anything competitive I wanted to do my best in. But I think badminton probably was the one that I was drawn to more than the others because of the like family aspect, the family element of the sport, that the sport had to me. So my dad was playing, and you know, my uncle played, my brother played, so I was just totally immersed in it more than other sports. I also feel like I had a great like foundation of coaches like you, like Dan, who really like took a liking to me when I was younger, and I didn't really have that in other sports. But even when I decided that I knew badminton was, you know, the one for me that I was going to try to specialize in, if I was going to specialize in any sport, even when I was younger, I always tried to continue on with my other sports because they definitely complemented my performance on court. So even for something as silly like as dancing, you kind of been working your movement and your flexibility, and for tennis, your grips. But then I think eventually it's important to, if you want to focus, to move away from the sports that you're not going to be focusing on, so that you can have more of a like a fixed mindset when you're training, you know, that this is what I'm doing, this is what I'm focusing on, I don't have to worry about tennis training or whatever. But yeah, that would have been, I suppose, the main reason why I decided to choose badminton over the other sports.
God, I was just thinking there, sorry, I was just thinking there because I heard what Chloe said. It's all the dads, isn't it? Where is the mothers? What has Audrey got to say to that, Chloe? Sorry, Sophia, I just had to cut across and say that to Chloe. What about the mums, you know? They do contribute, don't they, Chloe, Sophia?
Yeah, for sure. Like, I think my mum, I think like all mums, they want you to really push your education, and they want you to have a good life and to get your job and do these things. And
yeah,
sometimes when it's the unknown to go and train full-time badminton, it's hard for, it's easy for your dad. I know if it's just dads are like, you know, oh, just go and give it a go, and sure, you never know, you can always go back to school, or you can always, you know, where's your mum's more, can we say sensible? Is that
I knew you were going to say that anyways, Chloe. Yeah, I could hear that word coming up. Yeah.
Like she's been so, like she definitely has like a different approach to badminton, but she's just been amazing. I think what a lot of people don't notice, they think that the only supports you have are the ones that are clearly there. So if I was at a competition, they'd see my dad out on court coaching me, or if I was at training, they'd see, you know, my dad giving me advice and feedback. But really behind the scenes, my mom actually does a lot, and I'm sure it's the same for like a lot of juniors. You know, they drop you to training on an ongoing basis. They're working to help you pay for the training. They're like encouraging you when you get home. They're preparing your meals, and all of those things are equally as important as the on-court work. So even though like dad would be the main kind of coach that I'd have in terms of like people in my family, but my mom also helps me in like so many other ways that people don't see as much. So they're definitely there as well.
Yeah,
I would agree with that. I'd say your mom really helps you in ways like that you don't really see. You know, if you're ever really struggling, I think my mom was always the first one. I'd be like, you know, I just don't, I'm not enjoying it. Like, I really am homesick here. You know, I'm good to my mom. Or, you know, it is definitely the small things that they do behind the scenes that people don't see, because you always see your dad's always on the court, so it's like, oh, you know, your dad. But yeah, definitely I'd agree with that. Your mum is kind of doing those small things that people don't see, but they're such a huge part of it as well.
Yeah, no, that is so good to give them a mention. And obviously I have to also make the point, Mark, yeah, I do love, I do remember you and Chris Fusco, I think it was, the two of you on a court with Sophia and Dylan when they were so young, and you were doing this chasing game like you were a monster running around. And I know there's a lot of young juveniles listening here. I mean, it is in essence, I remember asking Dylan and Sophia, and she may not admit it now, why are you going down to Mount Pleasant and training with Mark? They said, because we love the monster game. That's why. And I was very disappointed. I wanted him to be working on the technical side and this, and he said, no, we'll put a little bit of that in every so often, and we'll do the chassis on the line. And you know, it doesn't seem that long ago, but that's you know, a long time ago now. And but it's kind of that fun element, and what you've been saying earlier on, Chloe, you know, make it fun at a young age, and coaches should be encouraged to do fun things on the court, not the strict stuff, particularly, you know, when they're that young and you're trying to bring them along to the game. So that's great, you know, it's great to hear that. And of course,
that was always my philosophy, was try to make it as fun as possible, because you can't play badminton if you don't want to come back next week.
Yeah.
So it has to be, especially at a young age, it has to be fun. And I can remember we did chassis, the monster game. You had to stay on the line and chase you around on, but you had to chassis.
It's bringing the fun into the technical side of things, and when you can just strike the balance, it's really important, because ultimately it doesn't matter what you want to do, whether you want to like pursue badminton professionally or you want to, you know, play it socially or not play it at all. If you're not enjoying it, there's just no point of continuing at, you know, training. So if there's a certain type of training that you dislike, you should definitely find other ways to do it. And if I was like ever looking at juniors, I'd always encourage them to find the parts of badminton that they enjoy. So if they enjoy match play, make sure that that's a part of their training, even though it may, as long as it doesn't define it. If they feel they want to work on other things like technique and footwork, it's just so crucial to know that you're actually enjoying what you're doing, because if it's your job and you're doing it every day, then you're gonna want to do something that you find fun.
Yeah. And there we have to leave it, Mark. What a fascinating first part with Chloe and Sophia. What did you make of that, Mark?
Oh, it was brilliant, John. Just the insights and the formative years. That we could call that the formative years podcast, and how Chloe and Sophia have developed. It's brilliant to listen to.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, listening to what Chloe was saying, you have to be on the court every day. This is it. You got to be when you get to the transition level, and you need that winning mindset. And I loved what she said about weapons, Mark. You always were a man of weapons, weren't you?
Yes, I suppose. Yeah, absolutely. Maybe not at junior level. You want fun and you want to teach a lot of technique. But certainly as you progress through the ranks and up into senior badminton, you need to develop techniques that you have weapons to hurt your opponent to win matches. It's a warrior sport. You're trying to beat your opponent, and they're trying to beat you, obviously. So the more weapons you have in your bag, the better.
And Mark, just a final question before we wrap this up with less than 2 minutes on our meter, because we spent all our budget today, but hopefully, you know, we'll sell a few shuttles in a few months and we'll be able to put more money into the meter, Mark. You and Bruce Topping, were you always fighting to beat him? Were you like Chloe was trying to beat Sam and Dan and Josh? Was it the same in the Topping household? Mark? I'm not sure if we've lost Mark here. I see him on the screen. Mark?
Yeah, I lost you there. Yeah, I just didn't hear what you said.
20 seconds. You and Bruce, did you fight battles together?
Yes, we did. Yes, absolutely. We were competitive with each other, yeah. We pushed each other. Yes, absolutely.
So we had the Toppings fighting each other, the McGees fighting each other, and I can certainly tell you this, the Nobles fighting each other too. That would be very true. So, listen, come to an end of another Badminton Talk podcast. Wow, can't wait, Mark, for part two next week. What are you doing this weekend?
I think I'm going to continue with my walking, John. I'm loving the walking at the moment out in the nature, out in the forest. It's absolutely fabulous at the moment. Great weather we're having.
Oh, wow, what weather. We're recording this on April the 22nd. Of course, we interviewed Sophia and Chloe earlier on in the month, but the weather in Ireland is so good. Things are looking good, Mark, on the COVID. It looks like we're maybe coming out of maybe lockdown another month or two. What do you think? 10 seconds.
Yeah, just listening to the media. Yes, it looks like there's an announcement next week. So there's a few hints and leaks that we might be coming back to badminton maybe June or July.
Yeah, coming back to badminton. That's what we want to hear. Well, thanks to the Shuttle, of course, sponsoring the Badminton Talk podcast. We'll see you next week. See you next week, Mark. Bye-bye.
Take care, John. Thanks. Bye.